perfect introduction to a talk on Aernout Mik. It's a group of art people in a church where they have really belong. The cell phone rings in the book introduction. You have this element of distraction. Even walking over here, we're noticing this kind of strange, straggly crowd, which is something I always associate with Aernout's videos. They're going through the streets. Now I use my phone.
But that strange, straggly crowd, it's not quite a crowd, is something that I associate with Aernout's work. It's a crowd which is yet to fully form, but feels like it's about to. Very different from the crowd that's here right now. So we have two videos, new projects by Aernout that he says are actually one project, and both deal with the subject of war. And war, of course, is a generator of crowds, crowds of different kinds. Wars divide us into camps, large camps. And the army is one primal one of a crowd. And the military uniform helps do what all crowds do, which is to make people anonymous and move. But there are other crowds that come out of wars. Wars make civilians into a crowd. Because it's the civilians who are now distinguished from the people in the military uniforms. And it makes crowds of refugees, crowds of prisoners, crowds of enemies, as well as crowds of friends and allies. And in a way, it seems to me that this subject of war has always been just underneath the surface of all Aernout's previous work, which has so often shown us images of crowds that seem to be disintegrating or engaged in some kind of destructive activity, environments that seem to be falling apart. And also, I think back of all the people wearing uniforms in earlier videos by Aernout, wearing uniforms of stock traders, cleaners, maintenance workers, and here, pharmacists. And here, of course, we have people wearing military uniforms. So I've written before about Aernout's work focusing on groups and packs and herds, whether these are people. We also see usually herds of animals in these videos. And that there are no distinct characters, individual characters, no one who you look at, who you identify with, you can single out as a psychological individual. And oddly enough, even the crowd is not really a distinct crowd. As I was mentioning before, it's a crowd that's on the threshold of becoming a crowd. It's a crowd that's poised to transform itself into a crowd, but it's still in a loose, uncrystallized state. And I think it's always been very interesting to me that Aernout uses actors who are trained to be extras in films as the characters in his films. That these are people whose job is to be peripheral, to be marginal, not to be in the center of a focus, but to be something that is off to the side. So when you're watching these films, again, he's taken away that central focus, and everything that you're looking at is something peripheral, which is a very decentering kind of experience. You have nothing to zero in on, in a sense. So they have a very diffuse focus. Now the crowd, I have this theory that the crowd is not only the subject of Aernout's work, but it's also a kind of aesthetic model. That his work takes on qualities that we associate with crowds. So when I think of the formal language of his videos, when I think of the temporal structure, the way he designs his installations, all of these things to me relate to the indistinct character of crowds. And in a way, they reflect back and they address the viewer's end status that you also are a member of a crowd when you're watching this. You go over to back and you become this group of people sitting on the floor, assembled in front of these screens, and you're not an individual on your own anymore. Even if you were the only person in that room, I think you have the knowledge that you are part of this crowd that stretches across time, all the people who will watch this video. Watched them already in one museum or another. So there is a sense that you're addressed in a way that I find very disorienting. I think it's because it's not the way we usually address our works of art, which speak to us as if we were isolated individuals, this very romantic notion of someone. And in Aernout's work, instead, I think we really have this experience of, in a way, initially, a feeling as if you're becoming as anonymous as the point of view of the camera, which seems to roam almost pointlessly across these scenes he depicts. And I have a definition of a crowd by the writer Elias Kanicki, who wrote the book called Crowds and Power, which if you're interested in crowds, I strongly recommend. And he said that in a crowd, a state of absolute equality exists, in which a head is a head, an arm is an arm, and differences between individual arms and individual heads are irrelevant. So there's this breaking down of boundaries in a crowd. And I think that Aernout's style of making these videos follows a very simple, a similar aesthetic principle. In as much as it brings together, merges and blurs together, and puts into crisis a whole series of aesthetic codes and conventions that not only have to do with image making, but also have to do with types of behavior. So that no identity is ever stable in these videos. And you get a sense, a very real sense, of what it's like to exist when you don't have a solid position, when you're kind of floating in what I think of as a kind of slippery socio-semiotic economy. Now, crowds love breaking down boundaries. Likewise, Aernout loves breaking down these boundaries. And even the crowds in his videos break the rules that crowds are supposed to follow. But I think this is not to say that Aernout is interested in transgression as a goal of itself, but more in an aesthetic of hybridization, of commingling and intermingling seemingly irreconcilable elements. That this kind of paradoxical situation is what his videos will focus on again and again, and we'll see this in the images from these two connected video projects, and maybe we can show the first image. Here is just a list that I think when we look at Aernout's work, we find these kinds of elements that normally we hold apart, but suddenly are brought together. And one is the fact that we have a kind of documentary verisimilitude, but that's paired with a very theatrical quality as well. There are these irrational scenarios that are depicted with the tropes of everyday realism. Beginnings and endings become indistinguishable given that the videos are structured as these seamless loops. And there's no real narrative glue. There are intimations of a narrative, but events don't unfold in any kind of connected sequence. And instead, they seem to consist of just a series of seemingly purposeful, but ultimately irrational acts. And even the locations of the scenarios that Aernout films are in between spaces. They're often spaces that are difficult to identify, that seem hard to know exactly what that space is. It's a space also that seems in a state of transition. And I think throughout these two new projects, Raw Footage and Scapegoats, we see scenes like this where someone is bicycling or walking down a street. It's a very everyday quality, except for there's evidence of something terrible that's just happened. So this is an image from Raw Footage, and maybe we can go to the next image. This is the first project in which Aernout has actually used real footage, and I'll probably regret saying real footage, but documentary footage that he collected from media archives both in the former Yugoslavia and in London, I believe, from news agencies. Scapegoats, on the other hand, is filmed with actors on a set and shows, you know, a scenario that resembles a makeshift POW camp, a prisoner of war camp, and where we see the identities between the captors and the captives slowly change, and in a sense they exchange identities. And both works, I think, play with the way that we're accustomed to seeing images of war in the media, whether in news footage or in movies or television shows. And they also show us, I think, the foreground, what's missing from those representations, and what's missing from the way we go about seeing the meaning of images of war, and how those images, what they mean to us. Interestingly, I think also, raw footage is the first time that Aernout has used sound in one of his videos. And I think to try to think of what the effect of that sound is a question that I'll try to come back to. Does it add a level of immediacy? Does it make it seem somehow more real because you hear the sound of a gun in the background? Raw footage is to some degree, I think, a misleading title. You know, raw, it reminds me of the phrase raw sewage, that you have something untreated, unsanitized, undifferentiated. And of course, there's nothing particularly raw about this work of art, and that the images that we see have been very carefully researched, edited, and put together, selected. For instance, I think with very few exceptions, Aernout has avoided putting in any images that show the dramatic, any dramatic images that show the horrors of war. We don't see any of the kind of photo opportunities that we normally see on television news. We don't see footage of the generals, the leaders of the military. And instead, we're looking at all the images that you don't see, usually, in the news. There was an Italian artist named Gianni Matti who did a project about 2 years ago at a magazine called Cavendish, which is published in the US, where he bought the rights from Reuters, I believe, of a number of photographs also from the war in what was once Yugoslavia. And they were very banal images that showed a field, an orchard, a farm, a highway. And in the background, there might be a puff of smoke. And they were images that these news agencies couldn't sell because they weren't considered newsworthy. And they were too banal. But they also, like I think Aernout's project, give you the sense of this startling normalcy of a wartime image. You know, we're used to seeing images of war that are very, very dramatic, that are given in a sense of Hollywood treatment. And I think there's an interest in artists to make up for, in a sense, to try to address all the things that the media isn't showing us. And so in a way, to take on the responsibility of being a kind of reporter, a very special kind. You know, I think what we get in raw footage especially, where again, we see images that leave us slightly confused for a moment about what we're looking at, how to categorize what we're seeing. Are we looking at people who are dead? Are these children actually fighting in the army, or are they just playing a game? Which people are captors, which people are captives? Sometimes you're looking at people in civilian clothes who are guarding prisoners in military uniforms. We also see a lot of images, military images, that remind us of civilian life. Okay, we see this guy sitting in a wicker chair as if he's enjoying a summer afternoon of tranquility. We see soldiers lounging under a Coca-Cola umbrella, talking on their cell phones. There's a strange mix of the kind of consumer reality that we know as an everyday experience and this foreign reality of warfare. And I think what Aernout has done here is to produce a very disconcerting portrait of a certain type of, what I would say, without wanting to be trivial, is a postmodern kind of warfare. And I think maybe we can say there are two types of postmodern warfare. One is the very distant spectacle of, say, the US attack on Iraq, a shock and awe campaign, which is produced to be a televised event and to be telegenic, to look good on television. And the other kind of postmodern warfare, I think, is this kind that very intimately mingles with signs of normal everyday life. And obviously, the most intense kind of, the most intense example of that is a civil war. And a civil war that's taking place not on battlefields between armies in full dress, but on city streets and in city parks, where people are fighting from offices or fighting from a cafe. And there's one image which I don't have that I think is very striking in this video. I don't know if it's still to show you, but it shows a female soldier who's wearing blue eyeshadow. It's one of these women in this picture, but you see her from her face. And it looks like she was on her way to go out on a date or go to the movies, go to a bar, and just happened to be running a military errand before she goes out to enjoy herself. And there's such a mix. I mean, I think I saw on the newspaper over at the newspaper review over at the back, which had the headline, Kalashnikovs and Lipstick. And I think it's bringing these things together, showing us these images of things that we don't normally associate, that makes it very, very close to us in a way that can be disarming. You can imagine wearing an eyeshadow. It may be harder to imagine carrying a Kalashnikov. But somehow, these images seem very, very intimate. And they also seem to disrupt our stereotyped idea of a soldier who's not wearing makeup, who's totally divorced from their life as a civilian, who exists somehow in a separate universe. And here are these two universes, the civilian and the military universe, are blurred, the boundaries are blurred between them. And one of the things I think that's amazing is that somehow Aernout was able to, using found footage, achieve many of the same goals, to use the same strategies that he uses when he's staging his own videos. There was another image, which again I don't have, an image I have to show you that I was also very, very struck by. It just shows a group of young people, including the young woman, sitting around a cafe, having a nice time, having their cappuccinos, as if everything was normal. Right behind them, you see this bombed out building that's almost still smoking. And to me, it was an extraordinary image of our ability to detach ourselves from what's going on around us. And I think, you know, war is part of your everyday reality. You accept it, and that becomes one element among other elements. But I think it's not that different from the way, you know, we might be sitting in a cafe and there's a homeless person lying on the street right behind us, and we can ignore that. There's a sense to me that it was a very, very canny portrait of, in a way, what the kind of consumer individual is. Someone who seems very disconnected, very detached, who really only plugs into the world. through channels of consumption. I'll get back to that later. So I think there's something very provocative. And this is a scene where the soldiers are firing out of their office. You know, here we wonder, are these men hunters? Are they soldiers? And here again, a street is an alleyway for a sniper. And so people are having to run across it. Here we have a lineup of military and a lineup of civilians and then sheep. And here again, we just get this sense of everyday life mixing somehow with this military reality. Which is something that's also very evident in Scapegoats. And I think to me it's very provocative when Aernout is saying that these basically consist of one project, the two pieces belong to one project. And again, it seems to me to be another way of blurring a crucial category. The category of reality, TV, and the category of staged reality. So it's in making this insistence that these two projects belong together, that they're the same project, in fact, I think Aernout is undoing a distinction that we usually insist on in order to know what we're talking about. Talking about reality, when we're talking about fiction. And there are reasons for this. I think in raw footage, we notice, even though this is news footage, it's not what we would consider completely objective. We see that there are moments where people are acting for the camera, and they're self-conscious, and in some way the camera's influencing their behavior. We also notice that some things have been restaged or reenacted for the camera. And Aernout himself makes the point that any and every frame, every time you frame an image, in a sense you're creating a type of fiction because you're excluding so much else from that picture. Now I would disagree with that. I would say it's going a little too far, because I think we do need a way to distinguish between or over a spectrum of reality. Some things might have a little more, we might call reality, some have a little less. Maybe there's no clear black and white line, but maybe what we need is a way to talk about the spectrum. Because otherwise I think we find ourselves heading towards what to me is not a very interesting conclusion. That illusion is no longer possible because the real is no longer possible, which is the kind of thinking we expect from Jean Baudrillard. On the other hand, in Scapegoats, which is a staged production, and this image is from Scapegoats, the way Aernout works, there's a lot of improvisation. Crowds of people, I think there were 90 actors in this production, are given loose directions. And inevitably, things happen which weren't planned. So, do we call that then that a certain amount of reality enters into this theatrical production? That it becomes a documentary of an event that's set in motion, that has fictional elements, but also has real elements. Now, the title for Scapegoats is something borrowed from the writings of a French literary critic named René Girard, who's lived in the U.S. for most of the last 40 years. He's written a lot about scapegoats and the use of scapegoats in deflecting potential violence within traditional societies. And he talks about how a society can unify itself by aiming at controlled collective violence at a scapegoat. So in a sense it becomes a crowd that crystallizes around the scapegoat. And so in a sense, Girard also argues that the thing that keeps people from violence against each other is a set of very clear social distinctions within a society. And it's in moments when that set of distinctions starts to break down that trouble begins. This is a quote from a book called Violence of the Sacred. He says, order, peace, and prosperity depend on cultural distinctions. It is not these distinctions, but the loss of them that gives birth to fierce rivalries and sets members of the same family or social group at one another's throats. And in describing moments of crisis, he looks at moments in these traditional societies, and for some reason, those distinctions that, in a sense, give order to a society start to become blurred, or the boundaries start to become unstable. Now, in a sense, when we use symbols, we're also engaged in a kind of sacrificial economy, in that we substitute a symbol for the thing itself. And there's a kind of sliding series of substitutions that occurs in works of art, like Aernout Mik, I think. So here too, I think there's a strange kind of sacrificial economy at work under a lot of Aernout's work. But not a kind of scapegoat economy. In fact, to create a scapegoat, you have to set up again this very clear set of definitions. And Aernout's work, of course, is doing the opposite. And in this way, I think both of these projects, raw footage and scapegoats, play against all the conventions and all the cliches of our mainstream media, like television news. And like almost all of Aernout's videos, both of these works, on the surface, seem to be straightforward documentaries, at least in the way they depict their subjects. They employ long takes, there's minimal editing involved, they're essentially non-narrative. And what they focus on is the character of discrete situations rather than a kind of narrative push or a psychological portrait. And at the same time, both of these works, I think, share an interest in presenting scenarios that generate multiple and ambiguous meanings. They mingle the preposterous and heroic, and they also mingle signs of plague with signs of social disturbance. And here, I think we find absurdity is never really an endpoint in itself, nor is there any kind of wrong irony involved. And instead, I think this absurdity serves as a way of derailing our literal-minded interpretations of what we're looking at. And it asks us to reconsider how the displacement of normal conventions that we're used to looking at in this kind of a film, how it functions in this situation. So these are some more images of scapegoats, where we're constantly confused as to, in a way, who is the captive? Who is the captor? We see people in civilian clothes holding weapons, guarding people in military clothes, people sitting down holding weapons, people standing up without them, and vice versa. And we're in an arena, which might be a sports arena, some kind of performance arena, that's been turned into a kind of shelter, but also a prison, where people are still consuming. And of all, I mean, it's very interesting to go to the Octonite for the first time to see this, the two pieces being shown together. Because if you look at them very quickly, you have a sense of how different they are. I mean, to me, of all the images I have, this is the only one that I could mistake, possibly, as being an image from raw footage, even though this is an actor. But it has many, many other qualities. But at the same time, there's something to me when I'm looking at scapegoats, and this is true. But it contaminates my sense of reality. I start looking at footage of real things as if they were all actually scenarios carried out by actors. It's a very disconcerting effect. When I started watching Scapegoats upstairs, and when I came down to watch raw footage, I carried that attitude with me somehow, even though I knew obviously what I was watching was raw footage. I think in all of Aernout's works, this idea of the incongruous, things that don't seem to go together, is part of a dialogue taking place within and raising questions about a larger arena of meaning. And frequently, a critical dimension of that arena is provided by the very location or the context in which a recorded event unfolds. And usually these are public places. I mean, I think, with a few exceptions, almost all of Aernout's videos occur in places that we associate with the collective life of society. But I don't think even in these works are in a sense is most directly political. And even though one can look back on this work and see a growing engagement with what seem to be issues having to do with politics, I think they're not so much about macro politics, the politics of the world, but about the politics of thought, perception, and interpretation. And those politics, though, I think are inextricably entangled with the larger kind of politics. But they occur in a field of subjectivity, and I think that art today, that's its domain. And that field is a field where we feel that change, however difficult it may be, is possible. And it's possible to start that change in these other kinds of changes. Now, I think in all of Aernout's works, I find a pervasive sense of disconnection. The people one watches don't often seem to be connected to each other. They don't seem to be really connected to the group they're in. The camera doesn't seem to be connected to the people it's following. It seems to make decisions almost at random. And one's own involvement at times feels slightly detached, because we're so used to a different kind of involvement. It's much more linear. And yet I think the goal of Aernout's work is to get us reconnected. And much more than I think videos that are based on the more cinematic and narrative model, it invites us to participate in a very active way and to try to understand and immerse ourselves in a situation that we may not understand, that we may not even be sure we can ever even resolve. But at the same time, we approach with the realization that it's a scenario we cannot detach ourselves from. And I think it's a recognition of that position, that we are immersed in this, whether we like it or not. That is the beginning of a more positive engagement. Reality, however one interprets it, lies behind a screen of cliches. Okay, this is a kind of truism, ideological critique. Every culture produces such a screen of cliches. Partly to consolidate its own power. As the critic John Berger once read, reality is an immigrant, it is with power. It's not something they really want to have represented. And in the past, I think for many modern artists, they thought of their innovations as offering a closer approach to reality, as a way of making reality more evident. Inspired, like the political revolutionary, by the idea of pulling down the screen of false cliches to reveal the truth. But I think Aernout and other artists of this generation, by contrast, do not pretend they can show us what's behind the screen of cliches, so much as what is left out of the picture, what's left out of the frame, what should also be something included. And in doing that, they invite us to sort through these abandoned and neglected pictorial ruins in ways that ultimately prompt us to reassess and to rethink some of our own fundamental assumptions about how we make sense and order out of the world and what the price is for that order that we conjure up. Now, Greek, the meaning of the word nomos, is the law, and it means literally that which is divided up into parts. So the principle of separation, of dividing things into parts and categories, is seen as the foundation of the law. And the noun for nomos, and the noun is a part of speech, right? Which names things, classifies things, categorizes them, defines things. Now the word hybrid, on the other hand, in Greek, comes from the word hubris, which means violence, excess, extremity, and outrageousness. And I think clearly Aernout's aesthetic falls into the latter camp. His art is posed not against the law as a site of reason, but only against its fixity, and a fixity that is sustained, as Girard describes in his analysis of religion, by violence. But the arts, and this is where I think we see how the arts really, really are so different from religion. You know, that they don't pretend, they don't ignore the reality of chaos, or try to mask its presence. There's a philosopher, Zygmunt Bauman, a sociologist and a philosopher, who said that in the substance of all great art, it is the substance of all great art, that from behind every form, it conjures up the boundless chaos of being winks. Each form informs and is but a form, a construction of artifice. And I think it's by transparently revealing this situation, revealing its own artifice, and revealing at the same time that windows, that art and images are at once a window onto chaos and a form imposed upon it, that Aernout reveals why we also give art the authority to question all established meanings, including all truths deemed to be beyond dispute. So I will stop there, and maybe we can turn the lights on and see if we have any questions.